Live from Midtown Atlanta in Studio V, it's the third annual Starters Awards Show. It's the Starties! And now, here is your host, Kristen Ledlow.
Good evening and welcome to the Starters' third annual NBA Awards Show, the Starties. I'm your host, Kristen Ledlow, and your boys are back at it again, handing out some major hardware to your favorite NBA people. Well, over the next hour, we're going to be giving out all the big awards, like Most Valuable Player, Rookie of the Year, and Most Improved. Plus, we'll pick a few winners in some Starters categories, like Wedgie of the Year and Funniest Moment. Later, we will bid adieu to everything that we lost this NBA season, so get your Kleenex ready. But hey, you can't have the Starties without the Starters. So here they are, Skeets, Taps, Trey, and Lee. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Kristen. Thank you once again for classing up the joint here in Studio V. We got a fun show tonight. I just want to quickly go through how the scoring works for each of these major awards. We had an impartial panel pick the four nominees. Then we all made our votes along with you, the Starters fans, on Twitter. Whoever had the most number one votes gets the award. It's as simple as that. We got a whole lot of hardware to hand out. So let's go right back to Kristen for our first award.
A freshman year is scary for everyone. Who's gonna be my friends? What should I eat? Where should I eat? What is converging hemispheres and why am I even taking it? But these four rookies figured all of that out. Plus they kept off that dreaded freshman 15. Your nominees for Rookie of the Year are Devin Booker of the Phoenix Suns. Jahlil Okafor of the Philadelphia 76ers. Kristaps Porzingis of the New York Knicks. And Karl Anthony Towns of the Minnesota Timberwolves. And your winner is...
I think we have an idea.
Karl Anthony Towns.
There it is.
Oh, yeah.
The big cat.
Huge.
Well deserved. And in fact, guys, we actually have Karl Anthony Towns himself here to accept the award. Big cat.
First off, I would love to thank the Academy for recognizing my work with Leonardo DiCaprio in The Revenant. I would like to thank Leonardo again for having such a great team with me in the woods and allowing me to attack him viciously. I much appreciate that. And without Leonardo DiCaprio, this is not possible. So again, thanks to the Academy, but thank you, Leo.
Yes, thanks to Karl Anthony Towns and Leonardo DiCaprio.
Thanks, Leo.
Here's a look at how the voting broke down. No shocker
here. Pretty easy one.
Yeah. Everyone, the fans included, going with Mr. Towns. Unbelievable rookie season. 18-10, can't argue that.
He's a unique talent. He's also hilarious, apparently.
Yep.
I didn't know that. He had that in his arsenal. I also didn't know that he had the step back, the floater. This guy's a 7-footer, a legit center. People compare him to Tim Duncan. He definitely can be an anchor like Tim Duncan of your defense, but he's got so much versatility. As I mentioned, all those moves for such a big guy, he's just so, so skilled. This early, he's so polished.
He looked like a 4 or 5 year veteran out there, not just on the offensive end, on the defensive end as well. Made some game-winning plays, hit those big shots, and just looked like someone who was ready to play in the NBA. And I think the Minnesota Timberwolves are going to be very, very happy with the future with him.
Yeah, not a shock that he's going to get Rookie of the Year in real life and here on the Starties. But I think he's going to warrant some all-NBA nods.
Absolutely.
That's how great a season he's had. He's already in the discussion, top 15, top 20, whatever you want there, of the greatest players in the game. And he's, what, 20 years old?
Yeah.
It's crazy.
I think he's there. He's top 10 in the NBA right now in field goal percentage, rebound per game, and blocks. And like you said, he's averaging a double-double, one of only 9 guys to do that with points and rebounds. He's just been one of the top 20 players in the league. And like you're saying, Zach Lowe gave him an all-NBA vote. It's going to happen.
Yeah. And look, unbelievable rookie class. Not only the four nominees that we had there, but other guys like Jokic. And, you know, you go down the list, Justice Winslow, Miles Turner, D'Angelo Russell, Emmanuel Mudiay. There are...
Porzingis as well. I mean,
well, he's one of the nominees, Lee.
Yeah.
Keep up with me, buddy. It's a great rookie class though.
Towns was averaging 10 points per game at Kentucky because Calipari was running those 10 guys out, and now he's easily Rookie of the Year, and we're already talking about him being one of the best bigs in the game.
So that's a lock. Congrats to Big Cat winning the first Starties here of 2016. Back to Kristen for our next award.
Yeah, guys, Adolph Rupp once said, your defense will save you on the nights that your offense isn't working, which to say these four guys saved their team's offenses all season and long. Ladies and gentlemen, the nominees for Defensive Player of the Year, Draymond Green of the Golden State Warriors, DeAndre Jordan of the LA Clippers, Kawhi Leonard of the San Antonio Spurs, and Hassan Whiteside of the Miami Heat. And the winner is Kawhi Leonard.
Kawhi Leonard of the Spurs.
Put your claws together.
Yeah, I guess we're saying he's going back to back with the Defensive Player of the Year. Really did come down, I think, for most people to two guys, Kawhi Leonard or Draymond Green. You three and the fans, you say it's Kawhi.
Yep.
I like to be the devil's advocate sometimes. I took Draymond Green.
Not
I think you can make
choice.
A case for him for
oh,
sure.
Definitely.
But I ain't going to be mad with Kawhi taking home the starty.
Before Kawhi won it last year, only two perimeter players had won it over the last 25 seasons. Is Kawhi Leonard going to start a Defensive Player of the Year perimeter dynasty? It's possible. He's just such a unique guy that he can operate that way because it's always bigs who win this award.
Yeah, and the game is definitely becoming a lot more perimeter-based, so it wouldn't be surprising if perimeter players kind of go on a run. If you need a guard to shut down another guard, there's nobody better than Kawhi Leonard. He's the best defensive player on the best defensive team in the league, one of the best in the 2000s, and he honestly has Deion Sanders status because people don't even go at him when he's on the court.
Yeah.
It's just like, stay away. Maybe we can hang on to the ball if he's not involved in the play, but even then, he's still getting near it.
I went with Green just because of his versatility, just like Kawhi Leonard, but, you know, Steph Curry is the heart and soul of the Warriors offense.
Yeah.
Zach Lowe put this well. I think Draymond Green is the yapping nervous system of their defense. And he reminds me a lot of Kevin Garnett when he was at his peak defensively, just in terms of barking out everything, going up to Curry when he's got a mismatch defensively and say, get out to the corner, the shooter in the corner, I got this guy. He's that great. He's so locked in defensively at switching and telling other guys to switch. That's why he gets my nod.
What I like about both these guys as defenders is they understand how to read the offense and know when to gamble for a steal and when to sit back and wait for it. They can actually create defensive plays just by their intelligence of watching what the other team does. It's not just about who blocks shots or who gets the steals. It's who makes their opponent uncomfortable. And both of those guys know how to do that very well. Like you mentioned, if a ball goes into someone, Kawhi Leonard, he can pounce on that guy, and often you'll see that guy throw it out because he just doesn't want to have Kawhi Leonard in his face.
Kawhi Leonard, the defensive player of the year, according to the Starters fans and, of course, us here. Over to Kristen for our final award here, but lots more still to come, of course. Kristen.
A philosophical question. If an arena vendor yells popcorn and there's no one in the crowd, does it even make a sound? Well, thanks to NBA fans, we never even have to ponder that question. Guys, why don't you tell me about the nominees for Fan of the Year?
Yeah, the nominees for Fan of the Year, we start with the creepy thumb guy. Showing off the dexterity there.
I love his friend laughing at his thumb. It's like, I've seen this so many times, and now everybody gets to see it.
He knows it's going on TV.
How about the Ramon Sessions butt grabber? Front row, he doesn't just grab it. He gets a good squeeze, a good handful.
What about, for Fan of the Year, the Dancing Celtics kid?
Oh, yeah.
He's feeling it.
Yeah, he really is. He's definitely going to hit us with a dap. Yep, there he is.
The baby dapping Will Barton. Watch this baby. Just a cash dap right there. Casual little dap. It feels like they've done this before.
He just takes it in stride like it's no big deal, a baby.
Wow, we got dabs, daps, thumb guy, butt grab. Who gets it?
Your winner is Ramon Sessions butt grab guy.
Yes! Congrats to Wilfred Brimley here.
This is early in the year, but no one could top this.
No.
No one could top you, mister.
You gotta get a good handful if you're down there.
Yeah.
Coming up next, the award for sixth man and the year's best wedgie. Welcome back to the Starties. Sometimes a team needs a boost from a reserve, like when Bill Murray saved Michael Jordan and the Toon Squad from a lifetime of working at Moron Mountain. But these guys didn't exactly save the world, but they are still nominees for the sixth man of the year. Ryan Anderson of the New Orleans Pelicans. Enes Kanter of the OKC Thunder. Andre Iguodala of the Golden State Warriors. and Evan Turner of the Boston Celtics. And the winner is Andre Iguodala.
Yeah, wow.
Nice.
Iggy, in the end, takes it. You think it's an upset, Lee? Interesting.
Upset,
you didn't vote for Andre Iguodala,
No, I didn't, no. Just think it's a little bit of an upset. I don't think people would have thought he would have had that top of year based on the numbers.
And you see it there. That's the starters' sixth man of the year voting breakdown. Lee, the only one going with Enes Kanter of the Thunder. Everyone else, including the fans, say Andre Iguodala, despite missing a good chunk of time near the end of the season and not putting up unbelievable numbers, but in the end, we think his impact on a 73-9 win team outweighs all that.
Everything coming up Warriors. Why Kanter over Iggy?
Well, I'll start with the numbers. A good solid 12 points, 8 rebounds off the bench, and I think a lot of people think with Enes Kanter, well, he doesn't play defense, so he doesn't have any real impact
he's
on the team.
That's reasonable. He's gotten better, he's but he gives up a lot.
He does give up a lot, but what's also overlooked is the fact that Thunder are 18 points better off per 100 possessions when he's on the floor. So, yes, he does leak a little bit defensively, but he absolutely makes up for it on offense. Also, he did play 82 games, came off the bench all but one of those, and Andre Iguodala missed 17 games. For me, I did take a point off him for that because I thought Enes Kanter, very consistent too off the bench, always produced.
You can always look at those numbers differently because they get outscored when he's on the floor, their defense is way better when he's off the floor, and you watch it, eye test, they're not good. He doesn't play fourth quarters for a reason because he doesn't play great D, and that's why you got to go with a guy like who makes the difference like Iggy in the fourth quarter. Kanter only plays 20 minutes a game.
I think that's a good sign, though, for him, that he can produce that much in such a short amount of time.
On the offensive end.
Yeah.
The defensive end is ugly.
Why Iguodala, Trey?
He's an integral part of their depth lineup to me, and he's kind of, along with Draymond Green, the reason the whole thing works. And when you look at numbers-wise, he trails only Manu Ginobili in net rating, and he played 600 more minutes than Manu. He just, to me, makes the biggest impact in the league off the bench. With the way he's able to play defense, move the ball, he somehow makes Steph Curry better when he's on the court, which seems impossible.
Yep.
He just does everything for them. His IQ is amazing, and he's just does everything you need. It was like when we saw him on Team USA, we said, Iggy just needs to be a junk man for any team and he'll be awesome. And that's exactly what happened with the Warriors.
I will say he has embraced that role so well because he didn't want to do it. Remember last season when Steve Kerr took over, he did not want to come off the bench. He went on to win finals MVP coming off the bench. And he's been fantastic. I mean, I'm not in any way discrediting his candidacy. I just think Kanter was...
That we can start looking at this award and not just going, well, just give it to the guy that scores 15 or 20 points off the bench. Like, you can have an impact on the game without just scoring the basketball. I think that's what Iguodala does, and there's a big reason for the record-setting 73-9 record. Kristen, over to you for our next award.
Now, without coaches, how would NBA teams know where to stand or when to shoot or who to defend? I mean, instincts, sure. Muscle memory, maybe. Years of experience also, probably. But nonetheless, it still helps having somebody out there directing traffic. So here's your nominees for the Coach of the Year. Steve Kerr, and of course Luke Walton of the Golden State Warriors. Greg Popovich of the San Antonio Spurs. Brad Stevens of the Boston Celtics. And Terry Stotts of the Portland Trailblazers. And the winner is...
We made these envelopes super difficult.
Steve Kerr and Luke Walton.
Wow, a combo win.
Wow.
I don't know how I feel about this.
Hey, if you can give Player of the Month to five guys, give the Coach of the Year to two guys. Why not?
Okay, tough to argue that.
This award usually goes to the guy who did more with less. Brad Stevens, a Steve Clifford, a Terry Stotts.
Terry Stotts, that's right.
I like how we award the team that won the most games in NBA history. That's what it comes down to. You're the best.
Yeah.
You're the best. Give them all the awards. Give them those envelopes. Give them to
just
them. That's it.
They
entirely deserve it.
Yeah, I think sometimes we can overthink this award and give it to a team that sort of surprised us, like the Portland Trailblazers. But really, 73-9, I don't think there's much you can argue that Steve Kerr, when he came back after the injury, Luke Walton did such an incredible job that they both deserve this award together.
What will they do with the Starty? They're going to have to just break it in half. It's cheap. We can probably just break it in half.
Well, if they win the real Coach of the Year, maybe one of them gets Coach of the Year, and then probably Luke Walton gets the Starty.
He gets
I'm
the
guessing.
Starty.
That seems fair.
I knew you guys and the fans. Fans were eventually going to give this to the Warriors in both Coach Curtin, as we call it, when you put them together. That's why I threw my vote to Terry Stotts. It was sort of a way to appreciate some of the other coaches, even guys we didn't even have in the nominees, like Steve Clifford and maybe even Eric Spoelstra. And you can go down the list. The Blazers, though, they lost four starters. We had them pegged a majority of us for like 25 wins, of course, out of the playoffs. And here they are about to start the playoffs as the fifth seed. Some people picking them to upset the Clippers. That's an unbelievable job.
I would say, though, if this show lost four starters, it would probably get better, too. Kristen, this show is yours.
It would just be Kristen Lelo. That's it. All right. In the end, though, going to the Warriors. Kristen, one more award here.
Now, is this the year we finally hit 50 wedgies in a season? Only, of course, the playoffs will tell. But in the meantime, let's celebrate the regular season's best netballs with the nominees for Wedgie of the Year.
The phenomenon continues to catch on. The alley-oop wedgie, Justin Holiday, Jimmy Butler collaborating on that. The block wedgie.
Ooh.
Dwight Howard getting Jason Smith another alley-oop wedgie. We're calling it the royal wedgie because it's LeBron trying to throw it down. You don't see him mishap too often. And the free throw wedgie from Kemba Walker.
That's incredible.
What a rarity.
Yeah.
Who will take this award?
The winner is... the royal wedgie.
LeBron James gets wedgie of the year. Put that up on the mantle.
Yeah, it's the only award he hasn't won, I think, so pretty much clean swept the entire league.
A bit of name power, but also just a very unique situation there with the alley-oop wedgie, one of 42 wedgies this season.
Huge!
We're creeping towards 50. Shall we get there in the playoffs?
Let's hope. I think we can do it.
Hashtag we are wedgie people.
Coming up next, TASS hands out the award that nobody wants, the worst of the year. You're watching the Starties on NBA TV. Welcome back to the Starties. We have already handed out six big awards, but there's still plenty to come, including the winner of this season's most valuable player trophy. Now, some people say mean, some people say Mimi, some people say Meme. Only the first people are right, and only these four internet sensations are the nominees for the Meme of the Year, guys.
Meme of the Year nominees. We start with LeBron James. He showed up, took a photo of himself wearing a trench coat, and the internet got to work, comparing him to Luther, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Nice.
Cowabunga, dude. And my favorite, Inspector Gadget, there with Penny and Brain.
Well done. Spurs Boban Marjanovic holding things, including this reporter's hand. Where did it go?
Give it back!
This Christmas tree is invisible. I mean, you can't see it.
Yeah.
Ray McCallum's shoulder is also gone.
Come on.
This is a gallon of tea.
Are these real photos?
That's a real hand.
Are we sure?
Supposedly.
Kevin Love, he was a little upset that he wasn't being included in Cavaliers team photos, so took a class from the Photoshop boys and just put himself in there.
You can hardly tell, can you?
Flawless. Just perfect work there from K Love.
This dunk from Aaron Gordon's incredible performance at the dunk contest was memeified very, very well by the internet. Starting with this high jump performance here, he would have won the bronze at the Olympics with that jump over stuff. He's jumping over legends.
He got over Muggsy.
He did. And then this claymation work, really, really cool. But the best one, he's dunking your emoticon and typing it for you.
Bang. Oh, man.
That's awesome.
That's a quick key right there.
And the winner is, well, had to be, Air Gordon.
Air Gordon, the meme of the year. And guys, actually, Aaron Gordon himself accepted the award. Let's hear from him.
What's up, guys? I appreciate the award. So everybody at the Starters, thank you, man. Meme of the year, Aaron Gordon's dunk contest. I appreciate it. Good looking out.
Great stuff, Aaron. You seem legitimate happy.
Yeah, that makes up for not actually winning the dunk contest.
You think it does? Yeah. I agree with you.
He won. He won.
Many moons ago, guys, we forbid Lee to put a simple bounce pass into the top 10 plays of the week. But since then, we've seen more backdoor cuts and pump fakes and, yeah, those bounce passes than we'd ever hoped for. Lee, time to take us through the nominees for very solid play of the year.
The first one is an absolute beauty from the Golden State Warriors. The ball fizzes around here. Look at a little bit of ping pong stuff here from Stephen Clay. Over to Leandro Barbosa, who knocks in the three-pointer. Not quite a swish bomb, but we won't penalize him for that.
All right.
The Dallas Mavericks showed us how to execute a fast break to get the maximum result here. Deron Williams for our...
Swish bomb.
That's right. And this one from the San Antonio Spurs had it all. The bounce pass, the ball fizzes around. It's a pinball machine.
Whoa.
And it ends with a beautiful pass from Manu back to David West for a layup. And sometimes a very solid play can just be a simple great pass from James Harden in this case. Look at this one for a bullet through the defense in Phoenix. Beautiful stuff there. And the winner is The very solid Spurs. As I said, this play had everything. Bounce pass, pinball machine, netball play, and it's basically the San Antonio Spurs second unit. And that's what I call a very solid play of the year.
Yeah, it's meant to be. You got Manu on the plaque.
Yeah.
It's got to be the Spurs.
What a shocker it went to the Spurs.
We're not done yet. We have the stats from the year compiled by Kaushik out in India. Fantastic job there. You can see every single team that was nominated, how many percentage of very solid plays they won.
Mm. Wow.
So if you think I'm biased towards Golden State and San Antonio, maybe. But as I always say, I don't pick the very solid play. It picks me.
There it is. Congrats to the Spurs B unit. I'm picking up the award.
All right, now it's time for the Worst of the Year award. Usually this dishonor is bestowed upon one person, one man that has messed up a whole lot during the NBA season. Past recipients include Dwight Howard, Dion Waiters, and Donald Sterling. But there wasn't one man who could steal enough of those negative headlines from one particular franchise. There wasn't one man who disappointed and shocked us like this team did. This year's Worst of the Year is the Sacramento Kings. What? A year. It didn't look good as far back as Summer League when DeMarcus Cousins didn't even want to talk to the guy who had been his head coach for 4 months, George Karl. In Cousins' defense, that was just after Karl reportedly tried to convince management they needed to trade him. And that's when Cousins showed his strong emoji game on Twitter. Not the first player to call Karl a snake in the grass. Somehow, Cousins and Karl started the season together, and as you'd expect, it did not begin very well. The Kings started 1-7, and after that seventh loss, DeMarcus unleashed a tirade on Karl in the locker room and in front of the entire team, obscenities and all. Karl wanted Cousins suspended for 2 games. GM Vlade Divac said nah to his head coach. 4 months, it appeared like Karl was on the outs. USA Today reported he'd be gone before the season was only 15 games old, but surprisingly, Karl stayed around and so did the misery. That misery was amplified during an early December game when first-year King Rajon Rondo verbally assaulted referee Bill Kennedy, unleashing anti-gay slurs at the ref. Kennedy knew Rondo was seething, so he tried to distance himself, but Rondo was determined. He stalked Kennedy and verbally attacked him. Rondo was suspended 1 game, but he didn't have a press conference to apologize. He only issued a couple tweets, which weren't an apology at all. The next day, the Kings issued a more thorough release because the tweets didn't say anything, but still, nothing real from Rondo. The franchise faltering again. Kennedy revealed he was gay days later to Yahoo. This was widely known in NBA circles, so it's likely Rondo knew that at the time of his attack. Oh yeah, basketball. The Kings were struggling there too. After the lowly Nets put 128 on Sacramento in February, Cousins told the media that energy and effort weren't the problem. But there was a larger issue in-house. Hint, hint, the coach. It seemed like everyone wanted Karl out, including former King Bobby Jackson on the local broadcast.
It was post-All-Star break that George Karl took over last year. It was the Friday night.
It could be post-All-Star break that he can leave, too. There ain't nothing wrong with it. It's just a business.
Ouch. Unsurprisingly, it appeared as though Karl was fired just before the All-Star break. Everyone was reporting it. Finally, it's happening. Nope. Fooled again, he's staying on. In an odd attempt to save some face by just firing someone, the Kings canned assistant coach, Vance Wahlberg. Huh? Put this in perspective. All of this happened before the All-Star break. The Spurs haven't had this much drama in their franchise history. But there's more. In early March, Cousins' temper got the best of him again. He lost it on Karl at the bench, and he continued the tirade on Karl and Divac after the game. This time, the team suspended Cuz 1 game for conduct detrimental to the team. Hold on. Why do we know everything that happens within this organization? Where is the leak? Forget a leak. It's a direct stream. It's almost as if the Kings PR department reports everything which happens behind closed doors directly to the media. From Karl's attempted power play, to the reports that minority owners wanted to oust Vivek Ranadive, to the firings which weren't firings at all. When Vlade Divac got his contract extension recently, I wasn't mad about it. Did he earn it? No, but this team so desperately needs stability. Since Karl was finally fired Thursday, Cousins will be welcoming his 6th coach in 7 seasons next year, and the Kings will have to convince that prospective coach that his job is secure and he won't be cast aside halfway through next season. Once again, the Kings are not postseason bound. Although, DeMarcus Cousins did win 30 games for the first time in his 6-year career. Bright spot? Even little-used Seth Curry tweeted that his head coach is a snake in the grass, before deleting it, of course. George Karl must hate emojis.
The Sacramento Kings, your worst of the year.
There you have it. It was an incredible year for the Sacramento Kings, and now we must raise their banner. Mm. Usually this goes to one person. Mm. It's always gone to one person in the past, but because of this fantastic year, if you can call it that, the Kings have earned this dishonor.
Should we be clapping?
Yeah.
It's almost like amazing.
It is spectacular because it always goes to one person. Let's clap like Rajon Rondo and DeMarcus Cousins did there.
Yeah, yeah.
Fantastic. I like it.
I wonder if next year will change in Sacramento. It's always hard to tell with this franchise. The Rondo and Cousins faction will be back next year, I'm sure. All right, one quick break, but after we got some great stuff. The Most Improved Player of the Year Award and the 2015-2016 Funniest Moment.
Welcome back to the Starties. Not every player comes into the league ballin' like Steph Curry. In fact, Steph Curry didn't even come into the league ballin' like Steph Curry, but with a little hard work and probably thousands of hours in a gym, they might get there. Here are four guys who actually did. Your nominees for the Most Improved Player, Will Barton of the Denver Nuggets. Jay Crowder of the Boston Celtics. Stephen Curry of the Golden State Warriors. And CJ McCollum of the Portland Trailblazers. And the winner is CJ McCollum.
Yeah, not a surprise. Unbelievable performance from him. And here is the Blazers guard to accept the award himself.
I want to thank you guys for the Starties Most Improved Award. I appreciate you guys. I'm a big fan of the Starters show. I want to thank my teammates, my coaching staff, and the organization, as well as the other teams, for allowing me to have such a successful season. Appreciate it.
I love that he thanks the other teams for helping him improve. All four of us here at the Starters, as well as the fans on Twitter, picking CJ McCollum. There are a lot of people who are nominees when you get into Most Improved, but it's tough to look past a guy that averaged under 7 points per game last season and bumped it up to over 20. That's an unbelievable. Yes, the minutes increase, but to triple the scoring load like that, that's unbelievable.
I don't think anyone expected it. I've watched him his first couple years. You know he's good. You watch him in the postseason last year. You know he's got the skills. But to be a 20-point guy this early in his career, I did not expect it whatsoever. I'm very pumped to see what he does with Damian Lillard come this postseason.
And yeah, the minutes definitely went up, but his per 36 numbers in scoring and assists improves. 3-point percentage is up, field goal percentage is up, usage rate is up. But the biggest thing to me is he's now officially the second option in Portland. And it's pretty important that they now have a foundation going forward. You might have thought maybe he's going to be a guy that comes off the bench, but no, he's definitely a number two guy, and that's a great place to start.
We know they lost so many players from their team last year, but one of the side advantages, I guess, for that was it gave CJ a chance, and Terry Stotts had all the confidence in the world from him. You mentioned it started in the playoffs last year when he got a chance, and then he's gone on this year and carried on.
Yeah, you said it, Trey. It's one thing to get the increase in minutes and then the increase in the volume of shots that you're going to take, but it's another thing to keep your percentages the same, or better yet, increase them
slightly
as he did from the field and the three and the free throw line. That's unbelievable. I want to ask you guys, though, did anyone seriously consider giving Most Improved to Steph Curry?
I definitely did.
Did you?
After CJ McCollum told us he likes our show, I gave it to CJ.
Yeah,
but Steph going from great to even greater, I think is very special. These numbers are comparable to Larry Bird's MVP jump. Nobody else has done what Steph has done from an MVP winner to this. Larry Bird's on that same level. But it's spectacular. I love giving it to a guy who's come out of nowhere, gone from okay to very good like CJ McCollum.
Yeah,
but this is special.
Yeah, this award is designed to recognize someone who kind of broke
out. Let's change the design.
Not someone who was the MVP last year who did get better. There's no doubt Steph did get better. But I think this award is more to recognize one of those players, unheralded guy, who got his opportunity. Sure, he got more minutes, but then he went out and produced. So that's why I think CJ deserves it. But Steph has improved for sure.
Yeah, we all decided on McCollum. I think what was more difficult, again, the impartial panel picking the nominees, whoever they are, was trying to come up with the four guys, because there's tons of other guys like Kemba Walker and Cam Bazemore, and it goes on and on and on, that you could make a case for that they got become better basketball players from last year to this year. But in the end, CJ McCollum, he takes it.
And Steph we watched him in the preseason. He had improved in the preseason. He went into the summer kicking butt. And you noticed it right away. The guy had expanded his game after an MVP season, unlike some others in the league who had some MVP consideration last year.
Quiet shot at James Harden right there.
Wasn't that quiet. But he wasn't all that healthy coming into the... But Steph just took it to another level, and his team followed suit.
I'm happy no one gave Steph Curry most improved player, though.
Yeah, I think
because they weren't talking about Larry Bird giving him most improved player.
Tom Haberstroh cracked those numbers. Why? I mean, that's legitimate. It's legitimate. He worked
his
butt
off. So what happens if he gets better again next year? Then he should just keep winning most improved?
It wasn't
even more.
You guys didn't pick him as MVP, your MVP picks this year. You didn't expect him to get this much better. It was a surprise to a lot of people. He'll always be better, incrementally better, but this was a pretty big jump.
It was a bit of a jump. You're absolutely right.
And I love James Harden.
McCollum takes it. Don't worry, Harden's not winning anything from the Starters this year. Back to Kristen for our next award.
All right, guys, fans of terrible sci-fi movies will agree. Now, sometimes the bad is just as much fun as the good. The same is true with the NBA. So here are your four Sharknados, the nominees for this year's funniest moment.
Yes, the Atlanta Hawks watch walking away from Coach Bud as he draws up a probably important play. Yeah, we got this, Coach.
He kept drawing that up. The mop boy hustle in Charlotte. Whoa! Look at him go! He's involved in the play, just trying to do his job, but look at him get out of there. Cool. Well done!
How about Bernie the Heat mascot trying to jump over 10, 15 people and just takes out the final three. But he doesn't even know it. He's
pumped. Care.
Yeah, he doesn't care.
The fourth nominee, this kid who gets plowed by Kevin Serafin. Hey, it's not your time for your 15 seconds of fame, kid.
Is he all right?
Yeah, he was fine.
Okay, good.
And the winner. I mean, why do you ever think he didn't make it? Bernie getting burnt.
Yeah, Bernie gets burnt. Weekend with Bernie. Trying to clear, again, so many people here, and just destroys the final three.
Still got a good percentage.
And Bernie and the Heat were nice enough to send in this acceptance video. Oh, yeah, one more time.
Bernie, on behalf of the Miami Heat, I'm super excited to present you with this 2016 Starters Award, the funniest moment in the history of the Starters Award. But what everybody wants to know is, are you going to do that again? Oh my gosh.
Three people unfortunately died during the making of that acceptance video speech. Thanks to Bernie and the Heat for sending that in. All right, guys. Well, from the highest of the highs with the funniest moment, unfortunately now to the lowest of the lows in our dreaded next segment here. Kristen.
As with any NBA season, it's not all smiles, dunks, and wedgies. Sadly, every year, things disappear from our NBA lives forever. Please join Skeets, Tass, Trey, and Lee as they say goodbye to what we lost this season.
Promises you would stay, promises of yesterday, that you'd be here forever. Now I can't hold you near, memories disappear, 'cause we can't be together.
They say, forget about the past, 'cause nothing good can last, but I can't say goodbye to you.
Just like a dream that you won't let die, like a prayer that you can't deny. Oh, I miss you. When the night falls and you can't hold on, when you hope but you know it's gone. Oh, I miss you.
Never been laid so low, having trouble letting go, holding on to the feeling. Never gonna turn my back, never gonna fade to black, never gonna stop believing.
They say, forget about the past, 'cause nothing good can last. But I can't say goodbye to you.
Just like a dream that you won't let die, like a prayer that you can't deny. Oh, I miss you.
When the night falls and you can't hold on, when you hope but you know it's gone. Oh, I miss you. Oh, I miss you.
Welcome back to the Starties. It is time for the granddaddy of them all. Sometimes, like last season, an MVP race is back and forth right until the last game of the season, leaving us wondering who's going to take home the league's most prestigious hardware. Then sometimes one guy is so far ahead that everybody else is just happy to be nominated. So without further ado, here's Stephen Curry and the other nominees. Oh, there you go. Stephen Curry of the Golden State Warriors. LeBron James of the Cleveland Cavaliers. Kawhi Leonard of the San Antonio Spurs. And Russell Westbrook of the OKC Thunder. And the winner is Stephen Curry.
Yeah, no shocker here. Guys scoring over 30 points per game on the greatest regular season winning team of all time, the 73-9 Warriors. We all have Curry faces there, along with the Starters fans voting on Twitter. And it was a runaway. I mean, you can't even talk yourself into giving a nod to someone else. It's got to be Curry's.
Not often do we have a guy who is entirely different than everyone before him. You get your Shaqs, you get your LeBrons. But because Steph Curry doesn't physically look any different than anybody else, you kind of think, okay, well, this guy's just a very skilled guy. But you underappreciate what he is, what he's doing right now. He is changing the game from the three-point line. He is like those guys I mentioned, your Shaqs, your LeBrons. He's changing this game, and no one thought that this would happen, especially because he's sort of slight and doesn't look like a LeBron or a Shaq or other monstrous men before him.
Look at the unbelievable numbers. Again, over 30 points per game on the best team we've ever seen in the regular season. And he joins the 50-40-90 club, though it's really the 50-45-90 club. Also leads the league in steals per game. And player efficiency rating, he leads the league in that as well. He's actually posting one of the greatest offensive and PERs we've ever seen in league history. I guess the real question is, guys, you know, we give him the Starties here, and I'm sure he really appreciates that, but will he be the first ever unanimous MVP when it comes to the real votes?
I think he has to. I think he has to be, because there's been some other great players this season, but Steph has stood out so much better than all those other players. And not only that, the record of the Warriors shows that he's the best player on the best team historically we've ever seen. Devastatingly brilliant on the court, and then all those stats back it all up as well. Yeah. He's efficient when he plays. Mm-hmm. He shoots the ball better. And we forgot to mention, he's made over 400 three-pointers this year, which was over 100 than the record previously, which was held by him.
Yeah, I think we're going to look back on this season as his MJ season. He's eighth ever in PER, joining LeBron, Wilt, and Michael Jordan. When you're in that class in the top 10, that's pretty impressive. And you always hear Steve Kerr talking about when the Bulls were going for 72 wins, MJ just dragged them to win after win after win. Steph Curry did that this year. You remember games like when he hit that bomb against OKC. Whereas just Steph Curry saying, we're going to win because I'm the best player here. Yeah. And he did that night and night and night and night and night and night, night
yeah,
after.
He's going to keep doing it.
He's incredible. Sure. So I think that he should be unanimous this year, but it probably won't happen. Something will come up.
Well, right. Yeah. Shaq in 2000 comes to mind. Allen Iverson, right, got a vote. Got a LeBron vote, in that unbelievable year in 2013. Carmelo got a first place vote sort of right there. Yeah, you see it here. You know, I will not be shocked if someone maybe in the San Antonio area or not throws Kawhi Leonard a first place MVP vote. They are on the great, he's on, and a huge part, of course, of the greatest Spurs team we've ever seen in terms of regular season success. We just gave him Defensive Player of the Year. He probably will win that in real life. I mean, yeah, it's weird not to give it to Curry, but I could see someone out there, just because we've never had Jordan do it, or Shaq, or LeBron, that they don't want Curry to be that first guy. I wouldn't be shocked.
It sure helps that the Warriors got to 73 wins, even it for the MVP vote. Although voters had their ballots in their hand way prior to them getting to 73 wins. And you never know what voters are going to do. People are voting for Donald Trump. It just, you just absolutely don't know what they're going to do. So one might go to Kawhi, but it really helps that he got to 73.
The fact that the Warriors won that series against San Antonio 3-1 may dissuade any of those potential, you know, people who are thinking we'll give it to Kawhi. Because if you just watch Steph Curry all season long, though, he just stood out. And Kawhi Leonard was, there's no doubt he's, in my opinion, the runner-up for MVP this year, because he was the second best player. But I don't think he had a better season overall than Steph.
Yeah, and you could make the weird argument that he does it more on both ends, despite the fact that Curry led the league in steals, playing for an incredible defensive team. It is easier, though, to say Kawhi Leonard may be a more complete player, but I don't see it happening. I also think people could vote for Russell Westbrook, though. 18 triple-doubles in a year where they have 55 wins. That's a great season.
That's what I love about the NBA right now. We got guys like Russell Westbrook, Kevin Durant, who we don't even have as a nominee. Of course, LeBron, one of the nominees. Guys like that, it just shows you how great the league is right now.
Yep.
When they're like the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, Chris Paul, go on and on. Best players in the league, whatever. You know, not that MVP is just slowly the best player, but you know what I'm saying. It's just unbelievable talent right now in the NBA. Fun time to be a fan. We got to take one more break, but when we return on the Starties, it's time to count down the top 10 plays of the year. Don't go anywhere.
Steph might have one of them. There's a chance.
Welcome back to the Starties. All the awards have been handed out, but one honor remains, and that is a place in the Starters' top 10 plays of the year. So let's take a look at the top 10 plays that made us celebrate, presented by
Ciroc!
That's right, at number 10, it's Dwight Howard introducing Kristaps Porzingis to the league. Porzingis was the king of the putbacks this year.
Yeah.
But Dwight gets them here.
Not that one.
No, you don't want to be put into the net.
At number 9, you couldn't have written it any better. Kobe's final game in the NBA, 30 seconds left. The shot that put them ahead, the game winner, let's call it. This was 58 and 2 free throws, made it 60.
That actually happened.
Yes.
That wasn't really a dream. Happened. That wasn't a dream.
Mamba out.
That's right, dropped the mic. At number 9 on the list. At number 8, top 10 plays of the year, Rajon Rondo with the unbelievable rebound. The better pass, behind the back, out to the three-point line, and Caspi knocks it down.
Months later, I still think he's going to shoot the layup.
Yeah.
No way.
No.
Kick out.
Rondo's with the new banner hanging in this studio.
Yeah, Rondo's never going to shoot.
That's a good point.
At Beyond's back.
Number 7, DeAndre Jordan in December, he thrunks Greg Monroe. He gets that knee up right into Monroe's chest. Monroe goes down.
Yeah, that looks painful.
That's
didn't
mean.
Feel good.
You even try and block it, that's mean.
At number 6, LeBron James on the fast break. Two-hand bounce pass.
Yes.
Lee, you got a bounce pass.
Yeah, beautiful one. It's right? A corker. Great finish, Richard Jefferson.
Wicked corker.
Wicked corker, mate.
Beautiful.
Nice finish, RJ.
At number 5, Zach LaVine continued the slam dunk contest in March. Easy. Throw it down. It looks too easy.
I know.
It just looks too easy.
I feel like I could do it. When I watch him dunk, I feel like I could probably do that.
Talk about continuing the dunk contest task. How about Aaron Gordon with a couple of dunks for us in the top 10 plays of the year? We'll start with the Dominique-like reverse. Oh, how about, windmill in traffic.
In a game.
Yeah, no problem. And then, what we just call skying. Yeah.
Wow.
He takes off from far, and he just glides through the air. He really is the Neek to LaVine's Jordan.
I like it.
A block at number 3. Festus Ezeli gets Blake Griffin to appreciate this. We got to get this angle.
Oh, that's a great one.
We got another angle for you here. He's going full speed. Blake is trying to Mozgov. Festus really. Festus ain't having it.
At number two, DeMar DeRozan demolishes the French guy named De Gobert. Oh my. Oh, oh my.
And that is a boost off the hip.
Yeah, that was cool. And that's on a guy that could have been in the running for Defensive Player of the Year in Rudy Gobert. DeMar DeRozan, number two.
And the number one play of 15-16, it's only fitting. It's overtime, time taken down. Steph pulls up 37 and a half feet. You remember this fantastic game on a Saturday night.
Game of the year, play of the year.
That, exactly. That is exactly what hashtag SMH was made
that.
For.
That.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Like, what are you supposed to do except shake your head at it?
The three-point line lit up. The entire arena lit up. Steph, giving Andre Robertson no shot.
It's only fitting that Curry comes in at number one in the top 10 plays of the year. He's going to win every other award, it feels like, at least on the Starties and maybe in the real NBA universe. Kristen, we can't thank you enough for hosting.
I mention it every year. A fifth starter. I mean, we got to round out the starting lineup.
Good point.
I know. Thank you guys for
And you're probably
me.
The best basketball player of the bunch. Lee's got a good jump shot, but I've seen you shoot as well.
But of course, an exciting evening of NBA Awards magic. Have fun, everybody. Drive safe. Tass, take us home.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, the grind for next year's awards starts now. All right, maybe after the finals.
Embrace the playoffs, people.
Where's the after-starty?
Yeah, after the starties, it's the after-party.